I've heard that there are going to be a lot of interaction and drama. So if you are here to relax and sit back, just think again. Okay, so a round of applause.
Thank you. Good afternoon. I hope you had a satisfactory lunch. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Wonderful. Okay. I'm talking about whole person learning, the new way. This will be an interactive workshop. And by workshop, my understanding is that you work. And I don't. So I will be asking for people to come and volunteer. You all look extremely enthusiastic. So if you please, you know, if I ask for volunteers, don't all rush at the same time. Okay. So this will have a practical emphasis. All the activities that we do are activities that I actually use in class. Before we do anything, we need to... what?
Get our audience's attention.
Yes. But actually, even before that...
Plan, think.
Yeah. Before that. Okay. Breathe! We have to breathe. We cannot do anything without breathing. And I think teachers take their voice for granted very often. Professions that rely on their voices, for example, singers, actors, they spend a large amount of time doing breathing exercises because their voice is their profession. Teachers, our voice is also our profession. But how many of you actually spend a lot of time breathing exercises, strengthening the voice? If you have a teacher who's ill, the first thing that goes is their voice. You go into the staff, you say, how are you feeling? Oh, very well. And it's the voice that goes, because we don't look after it. So the first thing we're going to do is a breathing activity. And this is just to warm our vocal cords. But breathing is also, breathing properly is important, well, it's vital for our well-being, our health, our level of stress, our concentration levels. So we'll do a breathing activity, and hopefully this will energize us. So you all need to stand up. By the way, thank you for reacting exactly the same way as my students react when I say, okay, everyone, you all have to stand up. It's exactly the same. Oh. So that's excellent, very authentic, okay? So what I want you to do is breathe in through your nose, deeply fill your lungs, and then out through your mouth. And if you want to follow my hand gestures as well, that might help you, okay? So breathe in through the nose. Hold it, and out through the mouth. Now, if we are breathing properly, we do need the breath, the oxygen, to go right into our diaphragm and mix with our cells and do all the healthy things that oxygen does. If we breathe in and breathe out quickly, most of the oxygen that goes in goes out. So it's important to breathe in, hold it, and then release it, okay? So let's try that again. Deep breath, breathe in. Hold it. And out. Wonderful. Okay. Now we're going to add some sound, okay? So when we breathe out, we're going to make this sound. Did you hear that sound? Do you know what sound it is?
Yes.
What sound is it?
E.
It's not E or E. It's a long, rich, vibrant, vibrating E. The roof, the ceiling is going to vibrate. The floor is going to vibrate. And all the shelves, all the books are going to come flying off the shelf. So, breathe in. Hold it. Now. Okay. That was not bad, but it could be a lot better. I mean, we've got quite a lot of people here. Some people obviously have trained their voices. Other people weren't putting as much into it. Okay, now this time it's going to be this sound. Okay, breathe in. Hold it. 3, 2, 1, now. I want you to do my gestures as well. Think about your voice range. Think about intonation. I mean, very often students, when they're speaking English, they put on this very mechanical, flat voice range. Hello, how are you? Fine. And they say it all in one, you know. Hello, Tom, how are you? Fine. Okay, now, next sound is this one. So let's put a lot of emotion into it, a lot of romance and sadness. Okay, breathe in. Hold it. 3, 2, 1. Ah. Okay, we're getting better. We're getting better. Now, this time it's this sound. Breathe in. Hold it. 3, 2, 1, now. Okay. This is the last one. It's the last of the long vowel sounds. I want you to think of things you don't like, things you hate, all the bad things that have happened to you during the week, and let them all out. And it's this sound. Okay. So really let it all out. Throw all your bad things, all your in my direction, and I will absorb them. Okay. So breathe in. Hold it. Now. Okay. Now, we're going to put all of these sounds together. So you need to have a really deep breath. And as you breathe in, I want you to visualize energy coming up from the floor into your bodies, energizing you so that you're red hot fire. I can see some of you are red hot fire already, but some of you are... Okay. And then we're going to breathe out, and it's going to be E, U, R, or but only in one breath. I want you to listen to the person on your right. And if they go, with your elbow, so, deep breath in. Breathe in. Hold it. Now. Now, the next activity, we're going to transform. We're going to transform into an animal. We're going to transform into a bird. This is a bird with large eyes, and a bird that can turn its head right round. What bird is it? An owl. Now, has anyone done this transformation before? You're all completely new. I should warn you, there are some dangers to transforming into an owl. If there's not complete concentration, sometimes it's difficult to transform back. I've done it many times and I've only ever had one problem. That was a bit embarrassing. Okay, now, in order to transform, we need to put our right hand on our left shoulder. We need to breathe in through our nose and turn our head right round so it's facing the other way, this way. When I say now, we breathe out through our mouth and we bring our head slowly to face the front. While we are doing an owl ooh sound. When our face is totally to the front, we will all be transformed into owls. This is a concentration activity, and there are some dangers. Right hand, left shoulder. Breathe in. Now, so hard. Usually when I do that, there are a substantial number of people who think, what am I doing? And they burst into laughter. But I have never heard an owl laugh. So. Okay. We need to breathe. We need to warm up. Breathing is important. For teachers and learners, breathing energizes us and warming up energizes. Basically, what I'm thinking about is how do we learn, the dimensions of learning? And obviously we learn through our body. We learn lots of things through our body. We learn how to breathe. We learn how to walk. We learn how to make sounds. We know how to run. We know how to drive a car, how to use a computer. And these are all doing activities. They're learning through doing. We also learn cognitively when we engage our mind, when we are ordering or matching or filling in gaps or mental processes. And I think very often in schools and education establishments, we overemphasize the conscious, the mental, the matching, the ordering, the categorizing, the sort of logic, rational processes. But there's more to learning than doing things and thinking about things. There is the whole spiritual aspect. We all have a self-image. We all have emotions. We all relate to things in different ways. And that is my understanding of what whole person learning is. And if we can utilize these tools, then learning, in, I believe, will be more effective. There are some traditional orthodox beliefs that have been sort of ingrained into our consciousness for the last 300, 400, I don't know how many years, that I believe are maybe not false, but they're sort of, they send us off on the wrong track. And one of those beliefs is that everything is matter. Everything comes down to the physical. And in its extreme form, it means people become obsessed with materials. Cars, phones, things, objects. Which is why we get this ridiculous situation where the planet will have no trees, no wild animals, no natural resources, because we're exploiting all of these materials. And I think quantum mechanics or quantum theory, of which I am not an expert, well, in fact, I know nothing at all, really, apart from one very interesting experiment, and that is when an electron was shot through a hole and hit a wall on the other side. And the electron went through the hole and hit the wall on the other side. Wonderful. And that's the first diagram, and that's what we would expect to happen. But when the experimenters made two holes, so the electron had a choice which hole, something very interesting seemed to happen. It seemed to go through both holes. How? As teachers, we can answer this, because we're used to possibilities, improbabilities, learners doing strange things. But of course, for scientists, this was work. And the answer, apparently, is that the electron transformed itself into a wave. And the wave carried through both holes. But what I would like to know is, how did the electron know when it set off whether there was one hole or two holes? And the answer seems to be that it's not matter that is the most important thing. It's not matter, it's not atoms and electrons holding everything together. It's actually energy. It's the bits between the atoms and the electrons. And for teachers, I think we understand this, because we know that learners, for example, are not bodies in the classroom. Every day we walk into the class, the learners have a different energy. Things are different. If every time we walked into the classroom, everything was the same in terms of its physicalness, teaching would be very easy. It would be like manufacturing a car. Well, I don't know if that's very easy, but it would be like that. The other thing is that we're sort of used to the idea of reducing everything to its component parts. So if we have a watch, we break it up and find out what it is. And this is the whole idea of empirical experiments. Try it and see if it works. That doesn't work in teaching. You try something, it works. You try it with a different class, it doesn't work. You go back to the same class, you try it again, it doesn't work. It doesn't work like that. It's not about the elements, it's about the energy. And even medicine knows this. Medicine knows that it's the attitude of the patient. It's not the medicine. You can be a pharmaceutical company and mass produce a medicine and give it to lots of people. It's not going to have the same effect on all of them. And in fact, you can give them medicine that is nothing. The placebo effect. But if people think it is something, they get better. How is that possible? It's possible because we can't think like this anymore. We can't reduce everything to its elements because the elements aren't the answer. And the other belief is that there is a cause and effect. If you control every variable, you can make a McDonald's hamburger. If there is no trust in the people who work in your restaurant, and you buy exactly the same ingredients and follow exactly the same procedure, your McDonald's hamburger will be the same anywhere in the world. That doesn't work with students. We can't standardize it. It's not like producing McDonald's burgers. And in teaching and in teacher training, we see this all the time. We demonstrate an activity, and then demonstrate an activity that I think is quite effective, and the trainee will go off and try the activity, and they'll come back and say, I tried your activity, Tom. And I say, okay, good, how did it go? Hopeless. They couldn't do it at all. And then another trainee teacher would come back and say, that activity really worked well. My students loved it. And then the two trainees start describing what happened. And in fact, it wasn't very different, really, in terms of the actual mechanics. But it was all to do with the energy and the attitude. We're going to do some practical things. This is basically a lesson that I have used, and it's exploiting a story. Obviously, stories are key, and context is key to language learning. And every lesson can follow a similar kind of format when we're exploiting a context. So obviously we have to arouse interest in the topic initially. Without that, the lesson's not going to work. There may be some vocabulary that we have to look at. We have to have some kind of task that engages learners cognitively. There needs to be some language work, looking at the language of the context. There needs to be some kind of practice, and very often, a story can be dramatized. And that's going to help memory, and it's going to personalize, etc. So this is a lesson. Did you see that image? What was it? A man on a horse. It was a carrot, yes. So the topic of this story is cowboys. What I would do now is perhaps brainstorm some relevant vocabulary. For example, always have your visuals prepared.
There they are.
Now, if I was digitally literate, these obviously would be projected, and that would have the advantage that they're much better than my rather poorly crafted pictures. But the advantage of holding them is I can control them better. So here's the first picture. I'm going to flash it. You're not going to have very long to see it, okay? Are you ready? Put up your hand if you saw exactly what it was. Go like that if you're not sure. Okay. Next one. And what's this one? Could be a horse, but it's not. Could be a gun, but it's not.
A cow.
A cow. Could be a cow, but it's not.
The sheriff.
No, we've done the sheriff. Okay, so I'm brainstorming related vocabulary. It's actually this. This is where the action takes place. What is this? Okay, you have to say it with an American accent. You have to say it out of the side of your mouth as well. Saloon. Now, the interesting thing about this saloon bar is the doors. Has anyone, or does anyone know how to enter the saloon bar like a cowboy? Okay. Yeah?
Would you like to come out and show us, please? Here's the doors. Walk through them. You said you know how to do it.
Somebody else. Yes, yes.
So here are the doors. Actually, if you come up this level, there are the doors. You're the cowboy.
Very aggressive cowboy. The only problem with these doors is when you open them, if you don't move, okay.
What are we doing?
Right. An activity that I use a lot, and you probably do as well, are action songs. Songs, all age groups, are a really good way of arousing interest and also introducing language. And the reason for this is songs have a melody which is memorable, or can be memorable. They also have a rhythm, and they have words. And what we can do is we can add actions to songs. And in fact, it's quite easy to create an action song. You just take a well-known pop song and change a few of the words to fit your context. And then you add some actions. And that's what I've done with this song. For example, what do cowboys do when they're happy? Or what do they say?
I'm going to shoot you.
No, that's... Yes! Okay, they take their hat and they go, yee-haw! Okay, so I want everyone to do that. I'm going to count down from three. Take your hat, spin it, and yee-haw. three, two, one.
Yeah!
But you're happy. Okay, so okay, excellent. We'll try it again. Three, two, one. Okay, you've got to concentrate. You can't fall asleep yet. So when I go like this, it's yee-ha. Okay? Alright, remember that one. What do cowboys' musical instrument, what's this?
Violin.
Okay, it's a small violin, a fiddle. Okay? So this is. Okay? Practice. Three, two, one. Okay, some of you might have to tune your violin. What do cowboys do when they cry?
They don't.
Cowboys don't cry. Okay, actually they do cry, but what they do is they put their hat down and they wipe the tear. Just practice that, your cowboy cry. Oh, you are, gosh. Okay, when a cowboy is convinced that they're right, they do this. That's right! Three, two, one.
That's right!
Great. And finally, what do cowboys do when they make a mistake? They swear, they curse. How do they curse? Yeah. God damn! And what they do is they take their hand and they slap their thumb. God damn! And then because that thigh hurts, they have to do it the other side. God damn! Okay? So when I do 3, 2, 1, it's God damn it, God damn it. But you're really angry, okay? 3, 2, 1. Fantastic. Okay, now, how do cowboys walk? Hands in belts. Okay. I think we're ready for the song. So remember this one. Let's just practice because you're not really good. Okay. Are you ready? Now. Stand up. Hands in your belts, walk like a cowboy. Don't forget the actions. You ready? Are you walking? Okay. There's one. Ah, this is a sad song because the cowboy has died. But it's also a happy song because he wasn't a very good cowboy. Okay. Hands and belts. There's one more cowboy in heaven.
Yeah!
There's one more star in the sky. The cowboy, the things that you stood for, like truth and love, never die.
That's right!
Carve your name with pride and courage. Let no tear be shed without him. Yes, him! We all would now be dead.
That's right!
Excellent, sit down. That's the song. So that's the physical side of it. I was supposed to do that in about 10 minutes, and then I got a bit carried away, sorry. So now we've got the mental, where we're cognitively engaged. I'm going to show you the story quickly. I want you to remember every single visual and text. and I'm going to test you. And it's not funny. You better get it right. Tell your partner what you saw.
What?
The story to them. Passively reading it and absorbing it, is we can elicit the story. Now I can do that with different prompts. For example, this means and. What's this?
And.
One day. What's this?
And. One day.
This is everyone.
Everyone.
What's this?
And one day, everyone.
This means repeat the sentence. So if I go like that to you, you have to repeat the sentence. And this one, you have to repeat all the story.
Oh!
This is good. This is excellent. We're going to elicit it very quickly because I think you know it anyway. What's his name? Elicit the dialogue.
For example, this side you can be the sheriff, you can be Willy the Kid.
Yeah.
Sheriff. What does he say?
What's up, Willy?
Yes.
But
you've got your register wrong. What's up, Willy, is something that might be said in a bar in London or something. We're talking about the Wild West here. It's a slightly different genre discourse. But you're right, in terms of the sentiment, is exactly right.
What's up, Willy?
But those aren't actually his words. Sheriff. Any ideas? Okay, I'll tell you.
Howdy, stranger!
Sheriff, practice that. 3, 2, 1.
Howdy, stranger!
Yes?
Are you
talking to me?
Okay, Willy? 3, 2, 1.
Are you talking to me?
Sheriff?
Yeah.
Yes, it's very easy. Yeah.
Yep.
Then what does he say?
Come.
Don't think so.
Yeah,
okay.
Give me your guns, Woody.
Quite confident, Sheriff. Okay, ready? 3, 2, 1.
Give me your guns, Woody.
You must be joking.
Okay. No one takes my guns.
With the little. Okay. 3, 2, 1.
No one takes my guns.
Sheriff?
As far fuck.
Nice. And then Willy says, okay, this is the best line. Eyeball to eyeball. This town
is too small for the both of us.
Do you remember the dialogue? Okay, let's practice. So Sheriff comes in and says, this is the cognitive challenge of this lesson. Here is the story, but the pictures are in the wrong order. What you have to do is put them in the correct order. The first to finish is the champion. Usually that arouses some kind of... Ooh! Go. Oh, okay. Okay? Is anyone finished? Champion. Now, what we're going to do is the camera at the back is not just taping this particular session. This is a film studio, and they're going to film our story. So we're going to dramatize it. So we need some characters. Which characters do we need? We need Willy the Kid. Now, this works well if it's a male Willy the Kid, but in my experience, it actually works very much better if it's a female Willy the Kid. We need a sheriff, we need a saloon barman, we need a narrator, or several, possibly a horse, possibly doors, dancing girls, cactus, whatever. Now I'm going to ask for volunteers, okay? Who would like to be Willy the Kid? Excellent. Big round of applause for Willy the Kid, if you could get on your horse. Anyone volunteer to be the horse? Yes, the horse. Okay. On your horse. Sheriff, you just sleep in an office, you have to be good at sleeping. And she's just, yes. So I think you volunteered. Well done, Sheriff.
Would you like us here or here?
I think on, when you're ready. Saloon barman. This is your big chance for Hollywood fame. Many teachers are actually fantastic actors. If you think that, yes, thank you very much. Who else we got? Narrators? A narrator? Somebody who can read? Champion, you've got it in the right order, I hope. Okay, you two. Well, you three.
All right.
In fact, if you go behind the podium, you might be able to use the microphone. Willy the Kid, scene one, take two.
Everybody was afraid. Willie had two guns.
The sheriff was in his office. He was asleep.
The saloon barman rushed into the sheriff's office.
Where are the kids in town?
Where are the kids in town?
Where's the girl?
Shake him. The sheriff, Harry.
You were fantastic. You should be singers or actors, not teachers. I just want to leave you with the thought that very often in teaching we sort of try to put things in compartments, we try to standardize, we have course books, we have tests, we try to assume that the learners are McDonald's burgers, but they're not. We need to think, I believe, in a more holistic way. We need to think about energies, what connects things, not what separates things. And trying to sort of exploit doing learning, mental learning, and more spiritual, the spiritual side of learning. Thank you very much.